Hello, and welcome to this LinkedIn Live session. My name is David McAdams. I'm a professor of economics here at the Fuqua School of Business. And I'm excited to talk to you today about ways to equitably accelerate the availability of COVID vaccines around the world. In particular, I'm going to approach this question from a game theory perspective, okay, thinking especially about how we can accelerate the global rollout of safe and effective vaccines to end the acute phase of the global pandemic as quickly as possible. Now, although defeating this pandemic is an inherently global effort, each individual country is in a race of its own to get its population to so-called herd immunity as quickly as possible. The fundamental game theory question to ask here is, are countries racing with each other? Are efforts supporting one another? Or are we racing against one another? What's good for one country, dragging others back? Game theory provides a helpful framework to think through questions like this and to identify ways that countries can work better together for our mutual benefit. But first, I think it's helpful to take a step back and make sure we're all on the same page about what game theory means or what are games. So let me do that for a minute. A game, as I teach my students here at Fuqua, is a remarkably broad concept. A game is any situation with multiple decision makers, we call them players, whose decisions, whose choices impact others. So wherever there's decisions being made that are impacting others, there's games. Okay, so think about a couple examples. Maybe already today, you played some games. You woke up, you brushed your teeth. What flavor toothpaste did you use? That was a decision. It impacted you, but it doesn't really impact others. So that's not a game. Okay? But maybe you had to travel to work. A lot of us are working at home, but a few of us, like me, came to the office. Now, did you take the car or did you take a train or some other method of transport that doesn't cause traffic? Did you carpool? That decision impacted you and it impacted others by reducing traffic. So those who take the train, if anyone is these days, are helping the rest of their community. Okay, so that's a game. Now, what about COVID vaccines? Now, here in the United States, we're in the midst of a very challenging rollout process, and the government and other authorities are making lots of decisions that impact who gets access to vaccines, how you schedule, make an appointment, you know, all sorts of decisions the government is making and other authorities that are impacting us, Americans, right? So there's clearly games going on there, but those games are domestic in nature. They don't really affect the rest of the world. You know, so the fact that I was unable to get my mother-in-law an appointment for the dose that she's supposed to qualify for so far, it doesn't impact people in the rest of the world. It's not a global game. And my focus here today is to talk about that game at the global level. Okay, so countries as players and the choices we are making as countries that impact other countries. So for example, the United States made a number of deals to secure doses for Americans. The Moderna vaccine is one. There's other vaccines that we've made those bilateral deals for. Now, when we make those deals, we definitely are impacting other countries because we are securing doses for Americans that by definition won't be going somewhere else. Okay, so now, as you can imagine, wealthier countries are in a better position to make such deals. And this is allowing richer countries to secure doses for themselves faster. So if you wouldn't mind showing the first slide, please, Jason, I appreciate it. So what's going to come up in a moment is a figure estimating how long it's going to take for different countries to get widespread availability for COVID vaccines. You see some parts of the world, including the United States, in green, but a lot of the world is in red. Those are places where vaccines, while available for some of us, won't be coming for most of us for a long time. And you can take that image off if you like. So this isn't a new picture. Availability of healthcare is unequal in this world, but there's an effort this time around, a global effort, to try to change that, or at least make it a little less stark. This is where the so-called COVAX comes in. Official name is the COVID-19 Vaccine Global Access Facility, jointly operated by Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, and the World Health Organization. As they explain on the COVAX website, and here I'm reading, COVAX is, quote, the only truly global solution to this pandemic because it is the only effort to ensure that people in all corners of the world will get access to COVID-19 vaccines once they are available, regardless of their wealth. So, and COVAX has received a few billions of funding toward that effort, and they've been working to accelerate development and availability of vaccines. But even so, just to be clear, the whole world will not be green. Even if COVAX achieves its goal, the best case scenario is that 20% of the population in the red countries will be vaccinated by the end of this year. So if everything falls into place, to use my travel metaphor, you know, the United States got up this morning and went to work on a high-speed train. In the best case, the rest of the world will be on Amtrak. Okay, so moving, but moving slower toward the destination. Now, that picture also, you know, raises some questions about the nature of the game. The green and the red countries, what sort of game are we playing? And here, if you could bring up the second slide, that'd be helpful. Well, first of all, how are we impacting each other? So one way is through funding. So the COVAX is raising money to help support purchasing doses for poorer countries from the richer countries. And this has actually been a challenge because at first, a lot of the wealthy countries, including unfortunately the United States, didn't feel it was in their interest to donate. Okay, so one question this also raises is, are we fundamentally in a cooperative framework or are we competing with other countries for doses? And the game theory language, there's this game called the tragedy of the commons. So a key question to ask here is the world, or more precisely the rich countries of the world, are we in a tragedy of the commons? What does that mean? And I guess now you can take off that slide. A tragedy of the commons refers to a situation where you have a bunch of players, in this case countries, who can make a decision that helps everybody else. So in this case, that decision is donate $1 billion to COVAX, which will speed up the end of the global pandemic. So when Team Europe, and that's what they call themselves, when Team Europe donates a whole bunch of money to COVAX, that helps the United States by accelerating the end of the acute phase of the pandemic in Philippines or some Indonesia. Okay, so now American businessmen can travel to Indonesia and have and do more trade. So rich countries, if we could all get together and cooperate, we would all benefit by ending this global pandemic. But individual countries, individual rich countries, may not have ample incentive to do so. They're willing to free ride on the efforts of other rich countries. So that's a sense in which there could be a tragedy of the commons here when it comes to funding COVAX. Fortunately, a lot of the richer countries have started donating money, and with luck, the United States should start pulling its weight as well here in the near future. Now, there's another aspect of the game though, which is where the doses go. Now that might seem as well as a competitive type of game, because if the United States gets one dose, then that's a dose that doesn't go to another place. Is this what game theorists would call a zero-sum game? Okay, where something that benefits me necessarily hurts you. And that was the question that we focused in this research paper that recently came out in BMJ Global Health, that I believe a link will be put somewhere accessible to you if you're watching this. What we explored was how COVAX could help change the game so that as rich countries try to secure doses for themselves, they can also be helping poorer countries at the same time. Hey, that's not a natural thing. The natural thing is for countries to race to secure doses for themselves and thereby exclude others. But if we think about this ahead of time and plan for it, we argue that you could design these bilateral deals in a way that increases global supply. Now, how is that? Okay, so here's where I think the third slide would be useful to show. There's something remarkable about this current situation because we're not just racing to discover, to develop a vaccine and then get it into people's arms. We're doing that more than 100 times simultaneously. There's so many efforts out there to create vaccines, and they're different vaccines for the same disease. Okay, so this is completely unprecedented. We have all sorts of teams developing all sorts of types of vaccines. A lot of them are going to fail. We're super lucky. A few of them have been successful so far, but a lot are going to fail. How do we leverage the successes and minimize the setbacks associated with the failures? Another remarkable thing is that ending this pandemic is so important that as we're racing to develop these vaccines, we're also racing to build up facilities, to stand up facilities to produce them even before they're approved. And so there is this example, the one I have in red on the slide, the Queensland vaccine developed by scientists at University of Queensland. They had a $1 billion deal with the government of Australia to provide 50 million doses. And they had already stood up facilities, investing substantial sums to start getting ready to produce this thing. But then it was discovered that the vaccine caused people to test positive for HIV. They didn't have HIV. It's just that the vaccine caused their body to produce some antibody that triggered the test. So they'd made a decision, well, look, let's not use this vaccine. It's gonna cause this problem. Now, when that facilities that had been stood up to produce the Queensland vaccine, what happened? Obviously, any doses that were produced had to be thrown away, but the facilities themselves, could they be repurposed to produce another vaccine? And this is where the fact that there's many vaccines at the same time comes in. And moreover, while they do differ a lot, there are a lot of similarities. So the Queensland vaccine was one that includes a protein that your body is trained to respond to. Another protein-based vaccine could well potentially, I'm not an expert on vaccine production, but the ones I've talked to have affirmed that these facilities could be adapted to produce similar type of vaccine. Okay. Now, in some cases, like the mRNA vaccines, it's probably unrealistic to expect Moderna to share its secret sauce on how it makes that vaccine, because mRNA technology has enormous future profitability potential and intellectual property and so on, secrecy. On the other hand, something like a protein-based vaccine, that's sort of in your sweet spot where it's not immediately obvious how to start switching to another protein, but with collaboration, you could accelerate that process. And this is what we propose, is that when a country like the United States or any other country makes a deal to secure for itself a vaccine, it includes in that deal measures to facilitate collaboration, technology sharing, and technology transfer so that other facilities also can start producing that vaccine. And some of those doses can go to poorer countries. So this would accelerate how quickly vaccines can get to poorer countries and accelerate the end of the pandemic. Sort of turning the game from one in which we're sort of in a competitive mindset to one where we're more collaborative, because after all, we are in this together. Okay, so that's my main message. It's been about 15 minutes. If you have any questions, I guess I forgot to make this announcement at the beginning, but there is a little bit of lag between me and you. So if you can include the questions in the chat, then those can be presented to me and I can try to answer them in our remaining time. Jennifer, I unfortunately just closed the document. So a little bit of lag on my end in terms of opening this up. Okay. So I see a question here. So you've spoken about ways that countries can cooperate to improve the availability of these vaccines in poor countries. What's the likelihood that that's actually going to happen? Okay, so that's obviously a very good question, but I want to point to some positives. It's always easy to focus on problems, but the COVAX facility has already made remarkable progress. The United States, in its most recent COVID relief bill, included, if my memory serves me, $4 billion or just like billions of dollars to that effort, okay, to help accelerate the availability of vaccines. The CEPI, the Center for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, they've been funding the development of new vaccine technologies and production methods and working with producers who are in countries like India. There's vaccine production in countries like Brazil, okay, in addition to the ones you may have heard of, and helping those countries get moving faster in producing vaccines is already a huge win. Moreover, we are seeing some deals that include the sort of things I'm looking for. For example, the United States did a deal, the so-called BARDA deal, that included some of these technology transfer provisions. So there is collaboration. My understanding is that even some of the vaccine makers are collaborating. I read a story that the Sputnik vaccine and I believe the AstraZeneca vaccine makers were considering ways to work together. Any other questions? All right, well, I don't see any immediate questions. But thank you for your time and thank you for your efforts. If you are working on this problem yourself in your own way, and together we can make a difference. Thank you. Goodbye.